Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. We give and take away. We give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name.
Good morning. Again, for this live stream service, we are in Collingwood, and if you're tuning in for the very first time, we're really glad that you're able to do that, and we hope, as always, that this service can be a blessing to you so that you can then go out and be a blessing to the people around you. We have been talking for a few weeks now about our Love Your Neighbor initiative. And we're excited about it. We've had people donate to it. And the general idea is that we just like to be of help, not just to our people, but to people beyond this community of faith. So we're happy to have an update for you this morning from Catherine Brown.
Good morning, everyone. I have been truly amazed at the response to our Love Your Neighbor initiative, better known as LYN, or L-Y-N. This past month, 16 church families received grocery cards to help them through this challenging time. Some of the breadwinners in these families had just started back to work, but once again were laid off due to COVID restrictions. Because of your generous donations, the Session and Finance Committee have approved that we continue to support our church families with grocery cards through the next months. Thank you all for making such a difference and helping this Lynn vision become a reality.
Thanks, Catherine. Just a few more things to share regarding the Love Your Neighbor. For the next 10 months, to the end of December, we estimate that we'll need $30,000 for Love Your Neighbor, $3,000 per month. To date, we have received over $10,500. We have monthly and quarterly pledges of over $9,000 for the rest of the year, for a total of $19,500 in just 3 weeks. This is absolutely amazing. Thank you. We already have more than half of what we need. And in the, I'll share a few more details next week in terms of how you could contribute to that, but we're really happy and thankful for your response to Love Your Neighbor to date. It's beautiful. A couple more things. Our sermon fellowship groups. We have two groups that have been meeting for 4 weeks, and we just wanted to see how it would go. A third group now will be starting on Tuesday, so we're really happy about that. We have a picture to show you. It's via Zoom. We showed you this before. This is Doug and Karen Barrett's group. And so we're, happy to be starting a third sermon fellowship group. Watch for an email coming this week with all the information. If you're not on the church email group, info will be on the website, so just check it out there. And the leaders want you to know that no Bible knowledge is necessary. The groups are meant for ordinary people looking for Jesus in today's times. And we did a survey for the people that are taking part, and here's three of their responses. I enjoyed meeting new people, sharing ideas and interpretations, and learning from others. Here's another one. The discussions were super. They gave me different perspectives on the message from Sunday. Even when we went off on a tangent, you never go off on tangents in small groups, do you? That never happens. And then lastly, I came away with a deeper understanding of the sermon topic through the sharing of ideas. So if you would like to take part, just let us know and we'd be happy to have you do that. And lastly, next Sunday, we're looking forward to our VBC reveal. VBC means Vacation Bible Camp. We aren't able to do it quite well. You know what? We're just not sure yet how we're going to be able to do it. So tune in next Sunday for the VBC reveal. And as a part of that, there will be a brand new choir anthem with some of the VBC children that will be singing in the choir. Virtually, and so we're really looking forward to that. They are singing one of our favorite all-time songs from this church. What song? You will have to tune in next Sunday to find out. We're so happy that you're here with us worshiping this morning, and we continue now with prayer. Lee Hanley will lead us in that.
Let's pray together. God, we come together into this place, and here we know we will find the presence of your Spirit with us. We know your Spirit is alive amongst us. Jesus said the Spirit brings us strength in our times of weakness, comfort in our times of loneliness and despair, and guidance in our times of uncertainty. We also know that here we are not condemned, but we are accepted for who we are. We remember Jesus' words, "Come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." God, help us to hear and to understand this good news, that you accept us, forgive us, and welcome us. And may we always remember that you call us to also give rest to the weary. As you have opened the door for us, may we open the door for others. May we see Jesus in the faces of the lost, the homeless, the hopeless. May the great light of Jesus shine through us, that they might find their way home. We pray this in the name of Jesus, for he revealed everything that you are. Amen.
Good morning. If I were to tell you that this was an apple, you'd all know I was teasing, right? Because certainly I must know what an apple is. And surely I know that this is not an apple. Well, you're right. It's a banana. I can tell this is a banana just by looking at it. And I find bananas to be completely delicious. In my opinion, they're the perfect snack. We often try to decide if a banana is going to taste good based on how it looks. And this one here, it looks pretty good. So what if I told you that this banana isn't very good? That the inside of this banana is all cut up, and the second you peeled it, bits of banana would fall on the floor, ruining your snack. You'd probably take the banana and look it all over and decide that maybe I was trying to trick you because this banana is fine, right? Now you might be wondering why I'm talking about bananas. Well, it's because the bananas are a great way to understand some pretty tricky things. You see, aside from being delicious, bananas are really a fragile fruit, aren't they? You can't just toss a banana into the bottom of your backpack and then throw all your books on top of it, or you'll end up with a mess. You have to handle bananas carefully so that you don't bruise them. And that part really reminds me of people. We're not fragile in the same way as a banana necessarily. I mean, we do bruise if we get knocked around, but I'm thinking more about our hearts and the way we feel on the inside. When we have people who are in our lives and tell us that we're no good, we start to believe it. We know that words can hurt even more than pushes and shoves because our hearts don't heal as easily as our skin does. So when we have classmates who are unkind to us, or coaches who yell at us to do better, or anyone in our life teasing us or calling us names, it hurts us on the inside. And we don't always see when another person's insides are hurting. We might have someone in our class who is being bullied, but each day they walk around with a smile and they're helpful, and we think, wow, that person isn't even bothered by the bullies. Or we might know someone who laughs the hurtful comments away and maybe even agrees or joins in with the joke. And we might be tempted to say, they don't mind. Even they think it's funny. But it's because we can't see what's happening on the inside. Just like we make our choices about whether a banana is going to be a good snack based on how the peel looks, we make our choices about how people are feeling by what we see on the outside. And just like a banana, we're pretty fragile on our insides. So let's open up this banana and see if we're right. Is it the perfect banana to eat as a snack? Or is it going to fall completely apart when I open it? This banana has not been treated with care. And we didn't even notice. On the outside, the banana looked just the same as this banana. But on the inside, it's been sliced up. From the first banana, we see that not only do we have to treat each other with care, but we can't be sure how someone is feeling just by looking at them. We have to peel them open a little to see what's going on the inside. And there's another way that this banana can help us understand something that's even a bit more tricky. We talked about what to do if you see people mistreating others or squishing bananas in your school, but remember that we are also bananas. And maybe you're one of the bananas that's feeling a little squished or cut up inside. Maybe the people in your life haven't been treating you gently. Maybe you're trying to hide how you feel on the inside by making sure you look fine on the outside. If that banana is you, know this. Bananas are fruit, and that means they have seeds. And even if a banana gets completely squashed or cut up or rots on the inside, the seeds can be planted in good soil and become new and wonderful through growth of a new banana tree. And what does that mean for us? God has the power to come into our lives, to give us new life, and the opportunity to once again have us produce good fruit. If you're starting to find yourself feeling like nothing more than a squashed banana, know that God has put a goodness inside you that cannot be destroyed. Know that no matter what struggles you are facing, God is with you. Know that no matter what other people might say to you or about you, you are God's masterpiece. This week, let's make sure we're paying attention to the people around us. If we notice somebody that's not being treated gently, let's reach out and help them, even if it seems like they're doing fine on the outside. And if we are the ones that start feeling like a bruised banana on the inside, let's remember that from squishy bananas come the very best banana bread. And God can help us remember to be the true masterpieces that we are.
Well, thank you, Julia. How did she do that with that banana? I'd never seen that before. Like she opened up and then it, well, you saw. Great message, Julia. Thank you so much. Scripture is from Acts in chapter 1, beginning at verse 1 and just going to verse 8. Acts is called Acts because it's all about the Acts of the Apostles after Jesus leaves the earth and ascends, and the disciples go out into the world as commanded by Jesus. And so we're going to have a look at these verses from Acts chapter 1. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." And then they gathered around him and they asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" And Jesus said to them, "It is not for you to know the times and dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." For us today, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We're really pleased to be able to share this song with you. It's called "As You See, You Sing to My Heart." I wrote this song actually about 20 years ago, and it's based on Psalm 40. Psalm 40 is not a unique psalm. It's a usual psalm in the sense that part of the psalm is about lament for the suffering that the writer is going through. And we all know what suffering is like in life. There's no human being that doesn't know suffering. So there's this lament aspect of Psalm 40, but then there's the rejoice aspect of the psalm as well, where the writer realizes that God will deliver him from that suffering. And so this is "You Sing to My Heart."
My call for you, 'cause you turn to me and you lifted me up a place higher than I could have believed. You sing to my heart, that's why I love. You sing to my heart, that's why I love. Sing to my heart, that's why I love. You sing to my heart. Poor and needy, always am I. Won't you never stop thinking of me? You are my help, my deliverer always. I will always rejoice in you. Cause you sing to my heart, that's why I love. You sing to my heart, that's why I love. You sing to my heart, that's why I love. Great are your wonders, they're too many to count. They are more than the hairs of my head. If I try to speak, if I try to tell all of them, I would be best just to sing. You sing to my heart, that's why I love. Sing to my heart, that's why I love. You sing to my heart, that's why I love. You sing to my heart. That's why I love.
Again, just welcome. We're so happy that you're able to join us today in this worship time. When we're talking about God and talking about all things church, the first thing that we're really talking about is developing relationships. Like, that was really at the heart of Jesus' teaching, friendships and relationships. And this building, this community of faith, our ministries, our missions, everything we try to do in Jesus' name, at the heart is about developing relationships, and it's about friendship. Think of all the songs, and this is a fun exercise. Think of all the songs you know that are about friendship. If you made a list, you've got a friend. With a little help from my friends, Kimberly played that if you were listening to the prelude. Waiting on a Friend by the Rolling Stones, it's one of my favorites. All My Rowdy Friends Are Coming Over Tonight. Do you remember that one by Hank Williams Jr.? Not really appropriate for COVID times, but those songs are so good for our hearts. Those songs make us smile, don't they? Because we need what those songs bring. We need friendship. We're hardwired to need friends in our lives. Now, having said that, we need to unpack what kind of friendship that Jesus wants for us. Friendship with who, really, is the question. So I just want to give you three components to Christ-centered friendship. Here's the first one. This is kind of obvious, I guess, but it's the first one. Jesus-centered friendship with each other. Now, these are the people that we like, the people that we love, the people that are in our groups. These are the birds of a feather that we flock together with. These are the people in the community of faith that we get along with, who you want to be surrounded by. Do you know, when the shadow of your life lengthens and you're on your deathbed, the last few minutes of your life, if you think about this, you're not going to be wondering about your house. You're not going to be remembering the money that you had in the bank or the size of the car that you drove. What you remember in the last moments of your life is friends, isn't it? Walter Gretzky died this week, as most of us know, and there's been so much amazing reporting on that online and on TV. And Walter Gretzky was this sort of symbol of someone who placed importance on friendship over almost anything else. Like, his son Wayne Gretzky has, I don't know how many hundreds of millions of dollars, and had asked his father a few times if he wanted to move. And Walter Gretzky did. He just lived in the same house that he raised the kids in, and his whole life was just centered around friendship and around people. Jesus-centered friendship is with each other. And you know, there's so much evidence of that when someone that you love gets sick, and it's like you would give any amount of money in the bank to save that person. Or if someone that you love is lost and you don't know where they are, you know, like you would give status, you would give prestige, you would give money, you would give material things. Like, it just, all of that stuff just is fluff. It doesn't matter anymore. When someone we love is lost or hurt or sick, it just puts everything into perspective. It sure does beg the question, why do we spend so much time and effort trying to achieve this when really we know deep down that this is what's most important? And so this building, this community of faith, everything we do here in the church is intended to nurture this kind of friendship that we have with each other. Okay, so that's kind of the most obvious component of Christ-centered friendship, the friendship that we have with each other. Here's the second part of Jesus-centered friendship. And I would say this is equally as important, if you can imagine, than friendship with each other. I would even say that it might be more important, and that is friendship with God. The Bible speaks about the Holy Spirit. Jesus spoke about the Holy Spirit a lot. And what Jesus said about the Holy Spirit is that the Holy Spirit will be the presence of the friendship of God with you. How does that work? Well, Jesus said, I call you friends. Before Jesus left the earth, before he ascended, there's this narrative where Jesus, after the resurrection, he ascends into heaven. But while he was still walking with his disciples, he said, don't call me master anymore. I want you to call me friends. Jesus calls you friend. He calls me a friend. And he said, after I'm gone, I don't leave you alone. I would never leave you alone. I leave you with the Holy Spirit. And what the Holy Spirit will be for you is my friendship with you. And it is a presence that nothing could ever take away from you. Jesus-centered friendship with God is evident in the Holy Spirit. I watched this great documentary about the making of Star Wars. Any Star Wars fans out there? It was really a great documentary. It interviewed some of the actors like Harrison Ford and Liam Neeson and Samuel L. Jackson, all these great actors that were in many of those movies. But when it all started, like the first Star Wars movie that George Lucas put together, they had no idea it was going to grow into what it grew into. In fact, that first Star Wars movie did so much better. They just had no idea. And now it's just iconic. Why? Because it's a classic good versus evil story. It's a classic light versus dark story. You have Darth Vader, who represents darkness and evil. I know it gets complicated later in the movies, but originally, Darth Vader is the representation of evil and darkness. And everybody related to that because we all have Darth Vaders in our lives that we struggle with and that we have to battle against. But then, there is the Force. The Force. The Force that is good and that is with you and that helps you in the fight. And people just connected to this whole idea of, may the Force be with you. Like, it just became iconic in our culture. That's why people love Star Wars so much. People wanted to believe it was true. And people knew it was just a movie. They knew it was just a fairy tale and it was just made up. But there is something innate in each one of us that wants to know that there is a force in life that is with us and that comes up alongside and fights with us and hears our cries and comes face to face with all the Darth Vaders in our lives. And for Jesus and for his disciples and for the community of saints ever since, there is the teaching of the Holy Spirit that is real. It's not a fairy tale. And many people in many churches will attest and testify to how the Holy Spirit is real in their lives. It's amazing as you go through the Gospels. There's narratives that suggest that every single thing that Jesus did in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is in the company of the Holy Spirit, 24/7. The phrase "filled with the Holy Spirit" is seen in those stories all through the life of Jesus. I just want to put up a couple of verses, starting even before Jesus was born with his mother Mary. In Luke chapter 1, "The Holy Spirit," the angel said to Mary, "will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." The power of the Most High. So this Holy Spirit came onto Mary and gave her this some kind of power, and she experienced and felt that power. And the evidence of that is she sang this song that we now call the Magnificat. Read that if you ever have a chance. "My soul is filled with the Holy Spirit. My soul glorifies the Lord, for he has been mindful of me." If you have the Bible open at Luke, if you just flip the page over to Luke chapter 3, where Jesus is baptized. "As soon as Jesus was baptized," Luke writes, "he went out of the water, and at that moment, heaven was opened up. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, 'This is my Son whom I love, with whom I am well pleased.'" So the Holy Spirit came down on Jesus, and what the Holy Spirit said to Jesus was, "I'm with you and I love you." Like, there was this incredible affirmation. The next page, chapter 4, I'm just going to show one more. When Jesus began his ministry, it says, "Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil." Now, flip the page just one more. After that 40 days in the desert, the first thing he does is he goes back to his hometown of Nazareth. And this is what we looked at last week. And the text in Luke says he returned to Nazareth in the power of the Spirit. And he read from the prophet Isaiah, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me to preach good news to the poor." Everything that Jesus does is in the company of the Holy Spirit. And the writer of this, is Luke, is just trying to make a simple point. The Spirit of God was with him. And then Jesus spent his life saying to us, "The same Spirit will be with you. And when that Spirit is with you, it will be the presence of the friendship of God with you. And there is nothing that can separate you from it." And we might ask, how does that work? And I just want to show you two things that Jesus said in terms of what the Holy Spirit does. And I guess the first question I would ask you in terms of friendship is, what does the Holy Spirit do? Well, imagine your best friend and imagine what they would do for you. What does your best friend do for you? Maybe you're sitting beside your best friend this morning or when you're watching this. What does your best friend do for you? Here's what Jesus said. John chapter 14, "God will send the Holy Spirit and he will be your helper." He'll be your helper. Isn't it amazing? Like, to believe, like, if you can believe this and find a place, not just to believe it, but to experience it in your heart and in your life, that there is a presence, there is a force that is real that actually helps you throughout your life. It's like a best friend that you can call up if you're on the side of the road at night and say, "I'm on the side of the road and it's nighttime," and they're there. This is the friend that's there in 10 minutes. Or the woman that'll just give you everything. She'll give you the shirt off her back whenever you ask her because she's your best friend. This is the image, the picture the Bible gives us of what the Holy Spirit is in your life. And Jesus said, "I leave you with the Holy Spirit, and he will be the friendship of God with you." I want to show you a clip. This is one of the best images I have ever seen for what the Holy Spirit will do in your life. Let's show this. Clip is sponsored by the Kleenex company, I think. That's the image. That's the image that we have of God in your life. Because every one of us has suffered injury, haven't we? And we have to know that there is a presence that comes up alongside us and helps us. It's just exactly like what you've just seen. That's the image the Bible gives to us of what God will do. The Spirit is your helper. Because that's what a friend does. And here's the second thing. The second thing the Spirit does. Jesus said the Spirit will come to be with you and he will be your counselor. He will lead you into truth. Man, that's a big one, lead you into truth. How many times in your life are you just standing at a crossroad and you just don't know which way to go? It could have something to do with your career. It could have something to do with one of your adult children who you're worried about. And you just don't know how to make a decision. You don't know which way to go. Like, that is just such a human thing, to struggle with a decision. And Jesus is saying the Holy Spirit will come into that and help you and guide you into truth. He will guide you into the right way of thinking. It's amazing. Now, if truth be told, sometimes it's not an easy thing to be led into the truth. Have you ever had a good friend sit you down and say to you, look, this is not easy for me to say, but I'm saying it because you're a good friend of mine. Have you ever had that experience? And they might say something like, I'm worried about you. I'm worried about your drinking. And I know this is hard to say and this is an awkward moment, but the only reason I'm talking to you about this is because I'm your friend. I wouldn't bother if I wasn't your friend. Did you ever have someone sit you down and say, I'm worried. I'm worried about you. You're working too much. You don't see your family. Have you talked to your family about how much you're working? I'm worried about you. The only reason I'm bringing this up is because I'm your friend. That's what friends do. And so the Holy Spirit comes into your life and guides you into truth. And sometimes when you're trying to make a decision and you get some help with that, it's just fantastic. But there are other times when the Holy Spirit will guide you into a hard truth. Sometimes the truth is not an easy thing to be led into. Like, we buy into all kinds of things in our culture, don't we? I mean, our culture bought into the truth for how many generations that women were not equal to men? I mean, how many generations did we buy into that? Our culture bought into the truth that colored people were not equal to the white man. How many generations did we buy into that? There's all kinds of truths that we buy into. Money brings happiness. You could make a list. Sometimes it's hard to be led into new truths. That's what God does in the Holy Spirit, because God cares about you, and this is the friendship of God. And here in this church, we try to be led into that truth. We try to ask hard questions. Who do we need to be? Who do we need to be in the future? What's important and what's not important? What are some things we do that we just need to let go of and other things that we need to embrace? How do we make those changes? It's not easy to be led into that truth. Here's what we finish with. This is the last part of Christ-centered friendship. And this has to do with seeking friendship with those outside of the box, outside of this circle. And of course, this just leads us right back to love your neighbor, doesn't it? Friendship with those outside the box. Because we can't just make friends with us. We need to make friends with them. Like I said last week, or maybe it was the week before, us and them need to become we at some point. And you know what? Jesus said, these things are hard. These things are hard to do. And Jesus said you wouldn't be able to do them without the presence of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will come up alongside and will help you do that and will give you strength. I have to leave you now, but the Holy Spirit will come to you and he will live with you and in you, and the Spirit will come and help you in all of those things. And I'm just going to repeat two verses from what I read in Acts 1. Jesus said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. Power to do what? And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and to the ends of the earth. The Holy Spirit gives you power and gives me power to be the body of Jesus in the world. That's what the power is. Because we think, how am I going to love like Jesus loved? How am I going to go out and be able to share like Jesus shared things? How am I going to be able to do that? And Jesus said, I give you that power. The Holy Spirit is with you to help you do those things. All the good things that happen here at this church, all of them are because the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit have been here and are here with us, giving us those things and enabling us to do those things, which is really what any real friend would do. Except the Holy Spirit is the same God who created life in the beginning. The Holy Spirit is the same God that fashioned eternal life. The Holy Spirit is the same God that raises up the dead. We have that power with us. You have that power with you. I mean, if God can do those things, create the universe and raise up the dead and fashion heaven, what can God do in your life today? It's a friendship. The Holy Spirit is with you. Just ask for its help. We're going to sing this song. Hey, this is another song about friendship. This is a hymn. It's a gospel song about friendship, and we all know this one. What a friend we have in Jesus. Thank you. Wanted to mention a member passed away this week, Doug Weber. We had a small service here at the church for him yesterday, and his family will remain in our prayers, and you all have people that you remember. Many of you are mourning the loss of a loved one as well, so we uplift all of those things to each other and to God in this prayer. Let's pray. God, thank you for this time of worship where we can be together and remember these great promises. In particular, on this day, the promise of the Holy Spirit. And God, for those of us who struggle with this teaching, not really sure how to access that power, be with them, give them persistence. In some way, show them how you want to come up alongside with them and help them in their lives. And God, you know, as so many of us need help in these troubling times. God, for all of us who struggle and for those of us who have lost loved ones, be with us through this presence, through this force in our lives. And as always, we pray that you can show us ways that we can be with each other and that we can love the neighbors around us, that we can truly be a light into this dark world. God, we thank you for whatever ways that your Spirit has touched us in this worship together, for whatever ways that we can be inspired now to go out and to share in this world together. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. May the great love of God, may the teaching of Jesus, and may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you to help you and guide you through all your days, both now and always. Amen.